Lord, you're mighty. Lord Almighty. Oh Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. You set your glory above the heavens and the earth. When I think of all you made, the sun, the moon, and the stars, no praise is high enough to express how great you are. What a mighty God we serve.
When I think,
for God. Hallelujah. So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely.
Yes, you are.
Altogether worthy. Altogether wonderful to me.
Yes, you are.
So here I am.
Together,
all
together. hold on, better days are coming. It can be rough in this world. I know it ain't easy, but hang on in there. I know better days are coming. You seem good, you seem bad, you've been happy and sad, but just remember that better days are coming. Friends will leave you all by yourself, but don't cry, 'cause better days.
Come on, somebody just put in those comments, better days, better days. Come on, better days. Do you believe that this morning? Better days are coming. Hallelujah. Listen, don't you give up. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. Oh, man, I wish you could get that in your spirit. You ought to just say better days. You ought to release it. Don't just put it in the comments, but release it in the atmosphere of your house, in the atmosphere of your living room, your space, where you live, where you dwell. Matter of fact, you all get some sticky notes and put one in each room that just says better days. You ought to make that a personal daily declaration that better days are coming. It won't always be like this. It won't always be like this. Better days are coming. We give God glory and we give God praise today because we believe that we serve the God who is able to usher us into better days. Listen, I know it may be tough and rough and difficult right now. I know so many people are going through so many things, but listen, you got to hold on to hope, because if there is no hope for the future, There is no power in the present. Your power to make it through today is to believe that better days are coming. Hallelujah. So if you believe that this morning, come on, just put some clap emojis for those who like to lift your hands. Come on, put those hands up in those emojis and give God worship and praise for the better days that are to come. Listen, we pray that as you have seen our ways to give this morning, that you are sowing and you are giving. If this ministry is being a blessing to you, we ask that you would consider sowing into this ministry. For our First Baptist members, we ask that you would remember our commitment to financially support our ministry so that we can continue to do the work of the Lord. Amen. 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 You can give through Giblify, Zelle, Cash App, or PayPal. The PayPal is @FirstBCFranklin. The Cash App is $FirstBCFranklinVA. And our Giblify, if you're not on the app or if you haven't downloaded the app, you can do so by giv.li/UMCOK0. For those of you who prefer to just send a check or a money order, you can do that by sending it to 318 Hall Street. That's 318 Hall Street, Franklin, Virginia, 23851. So we thank God for you and for your financial support. Listen, today I am glad to share this space with one of my dear friends today. And I've asked him to come and to share a word with us. So don't you tune out. Amen. I want you to stick around because he's going to bless us today with the word from the Lord. So I'm going to ask that you would at this time give a very warm First Baptist Church Franklin welcome to my friend and brother, the Reverend Nathan Caldwell, who's going to bless us today with the word. Can you give him some clap emojis and welcome him? Somebody just, come on, give those clap emojis. Somebody just say, welcome, Reverend Caldwell, so he feels welcome with us today. At this time, without further ado, we're going to hear the word from the Lord given to us through the vessel of my friend, Reverend Nathan Caldwell.
Amen. Amen. Thank God for this opportunity. All glory, honor, and praise be to our Father and to his Son, Jesus Christ. How we thank and praise him for the power and the presence of his Holy Spirit in our lives on today. For the Lord is good. It's so good to see you all. I greet you all the way from Detroit, Michigan. I didn't even have to catch the plane. So I thank God that I'm able to share with my brother and my friend, Pastor Marcus Jennings. Thank God for his leadership. He could have called literally anyone in the country, but he decided to allow me to tap in and talk to you. I thank God also for First Lady Jennings. I don't know where you are. I hope you you tapped in somewhere also on this line. Also, I think my wife is somewhere on here. So I thank God for her. There is a word. There is a word. If you have your Bibles, no matter where you are, I want you to turn to the book of Hebrews. The book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 10. Verse 23 and 24, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23 and 24, whatever platform you find yourself on, whether it be a tablet, an actual book in your hand, find your way there. I'll be reading from the King James Version. Your version might read a little bit different, but whatever it says, just know that it's the word of God. It says, verse 23, let us hold fast to the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. I want to talk briefly from the thought We need help at home. We're getting help at home. Let's pray and we'll dive into the word. Gracious God, our Father, we just say thank you. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your favor. Thank you for grace and mercy. God, I pray in Jesus' name that you would let this word fall on good ground. God, have us to be able to apply it to our lives and apply it throughout the week. God, we give you thanks. We give you glory. Bless us now. In the strong name of Jesus, we prayed. Amen. And thank God. So, church, I want to talk about help at home. We're in the book of Hebrews. When I think about where we are right now in this pandemic or this stay at home charge, I don't know about you, but I need some help at home. I've been dealing with financial issues. I've been dealing with home life and all those things. It just dealing with my kids. I have a new appreciation for my children's teachers. I'm at a place now that I have to believe the teacher when they say what they say, because the version of my kids, usually me and my wife, we both work. And we usually see them maybe 2 or 3 hours in the morning and maybe 5 or 6 hours at night. But I've never done that whole 8 hour gap. So the 8 hour version of my kids is a different version of them when they come home. And so I really appreciate all of the educators that's working, because not only am I having to be a parent, but I'm also having to be a science teacher. I'm also having to be the gym teacher. I'm also having to be the disciplinarian, the principal, and the dean. And so I need help at home. For some of us, you're not making the same amount of money that you were. You're not able to cash out like you wanted to. And so you need some help. And some of us, it might not be family. It might not be finances. But for some of us, it might be our faith. We're trying to figure out God in this season. And so we're at a place where we're trying to get a word because we need help at home. And so we're brought to the circumference of this text. We're in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23 and 24. But in order to appreciate this text, we got to understand the context. Understand that it is the Apostle Paul that's writing this book. But what he does, he does a throwback Thursday and makes reference to Old Testament customs. He literally says, I want you guys to remember the sacrifices to forgive sin. He makes a reference to having to kill bulls and goats and animals and the shedding of blood of animals to atone for sin. It was to the point that did we have to kill animals to atone for sin to get God's forgiveness? But then moving on through history, Moses, this whole idea was passed down to Moses, and Moses had to actually input and create a system in which our sins can be atoned. And so he created an actual system. But as time went on, the blood of animals, it didn't just forgive our sin, but it would just simply forgive our sin, but not take away our guilt. It would forgive our sin, but not take away the depression or the disdain. And so what God had to do, God regrouped and said, the blood of goats and bulls is not enough. So what I'll do, I'll send my son, Jesus, and that would be the perfect spill of blood. It's the blood of Jesus, the same Jesus that had nails driven in his hands and nails driven in his feet, the same Jesus that had a crown of thorns on his head. It's the blood of Jesus. I don't know where you are. If you're in your bed, if you're in your living room, if you're at your dining room, I want you to put in the comment section, it's nothing but the blood. I know we look good right now, but we're here today because we're covered in the blood of Jesus. The reason why we're here today is because of the blood. Understand this, y'all, that someone this week that's your age died, but God saw fit to let you see another day. And we're here because of the blood. And the Apostle Paul says, I don't want you to forget. And so we find ourselves in verse 23, verse 23 says, let us hold fast. Let's hold tight to the profession of our faith. We got to hold tight to the profession of our faith. So church, watch this. If you need help at home, there's three things. I got three movements and I'll be done. If you need help at home, church, number one, you got to hold on to your hope. Yeah. If you're gonna have help at home, number one, you gotta hold on to your hope. The text says you gotta hold on to the profession of your faith. This word faith in the Greek, it's translated to hope. Hope is defined as in the dictionary as expectation. So literally the text is suggesting you gotta hold on to your expectation. This is a season where you're expecting God to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you could ask or think. He says, hold on to your expectation. When things don't seem to pan out, you gotta hold on. When things don't seem to make sense, you got to hold on. When you seem stressed out, strained, upset, mad, you're letting your hair fall out. I want you to know, don't let that break you down, because God is not trying to break you. He's trying to build you, and he wants you to hold on. What this pandemic has done, it has exposed where the level of my faith is. It has exposed the level of my consistency and my prayer life. And in this season, you got to be able to hold on. But watch what the text says. I love the wording of the text, y'all. The wording of the text says, hold on to the profession of your faith. I love it, y'all, because this is a hot one. Because, y'all, there is a difference between profession and confession. Woo, man, put that thing in the comments, y'all. There's a difference between profession and confession. Watch this. Confession suggests that I did something and I have to admit to it, therefore I'm sorry. While profession says something was done for me and I have to make a pledge and say thank you. Ooh, Lord have mercy. I thank God, because watch this. I make a profession because God allowed me to live past my confession. Yeah, there's some things that I've been in. There's some conversations that I had that God didn't get glory out of. And so I have to make a confession. But because of the blood and because of his love, I can make a profession and say that if it had not been for God that was on my side, and I can make that profession and say, God, thank you for being faithful to me. I gotta make a profession. In other words, church, I gotta say something. I'm reminded of a story of a young man. He went to church. He went to his grandmother's church. It was Easter, and the senior pastor saw him. He remembered the young man from his youth. And so after church, after the benediction, they were shaking hands after church. And the pastor said to the young man, he said, young man, I don't see you much around here. You need to join the army of the Lord. You need to join the army of the Lord. And the young man said, pastor, I am a part of the army of the Lord. I really am. And then the pastor rebutted and said, no, you can't be a part of the army of the Lord, because I only see you on Christmas, Mother's Day, and Easter. And then the young man looked him square in the eye and he said, pastor, I am a part of the army of the Lord. I'm just a part of the Secret Service branch. Lord have mercy. In this season, you ain't got time to keep God a secret. If you believe God, in this moment, in this time, the world wants to hear your response. The world wants to know that you believe God. The world wants to know that you're standing on his word. Even in the midst of this catastrophic pandemic, God wants to know, will you share out that you believe me? And so if you're going to have help at home, number one, you got to hold on to your hope. But number two, if you're going to have help at home, you got to understand that he has the power to keep his promises. He has the power to keep his promises. Preacher, where you get that from? I'm still in verse 23. I'm in the B clause of verse 23. Verse 23 says he is faithful that promised. He's faithful that promise. When it comes to, this is a hot one, when it comes to the promises of God, God will remember your past. bless you in your present and push you into your future. Again, when it comes to God's promises, he'll remember your past. He'll bless you in your present, and then he'll push you in your future. Understand this. All that you've gone through, God had a plan and a purpose for your life. All of the issues, all of the problems, all of the anxiety, all of the heartbreak, all of the headache, all of this happened for a reason. Understand this. I'm not saying that God made this pandemic happen, but I am saying that God allowed some things to happen to develop you and nurture you and cultivate you. And in this season, what God is doing, he is making sure that he makes you a prize and a display for others to see. He blesses. He remembers your past. He blesses you in your present. And he pushes you into your future. Understand this, y'all. For some of us, that's why the Bible says, and we know that all things work together for the good of them that love God, to them that are called according to his purpose, which means everything that I go through, it's all to come together and work for my good. In this season, y'all, in this pandemic, in this stay-at-home charge, I don't know how it is in Virginia, but in Michigan, we got to stay home. And I figured out that there's some people in this space, I'm not talking to all of you, but there's some people in this space that while you have this free time, God is trying to develop a new book. God is trying to give you time to finish that degree. God is giving you time to start that new entrepreneurial idea. God is trying to give you time to get your life together. But then there's another group that what God is trying to speak to. He ain't trying to get a new book out of you. He ain't trying to get a new job. God ain't trying to put you on the run. He ain't even trying to connect you with nobody. In this season, God needs you to rest. Yeah. I don't know who that word is for. In this season, God needs some of y'all to sit down. In this season, God needs some of y'all to be quiet, don't say nothing, and move in silence. In this season, God is trying to develop two types of people in this room. He's trying to develop those, watch this, in this space, he's trying to develop those to be go-getters, and then he's trying to develop those to have a reset and sit down and reflect. Church, I'm at my last point. It's been fun. Watch this. If you're going to have help at home, number one, you got to hold on to your hope. Number two, if you're going to have help at home, you got to realize that he has power to keep his promise. But church, number three, if you're going to have help at home, you got to, this will show if you really have the Holy Ghost. Watch this. I'm in verse 24. What I love about verse 24 is different from verse 23 because it exposes you the real reality, in fact, who really has the Holy Spirit in their lives and the Holy Spirit at work in their lives. Preacher, how in the world does verse 24 expose if you have the Holy Spirit in your life? Verse 24 says, and let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. Preacher, how do you know this exposes if I got the Holy Ghost or not? Well, I'm glad you asked. Well, the first fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5 and 22 is love. Lord have mercy. See, the thing is, ain't no need of you saying that you got the Holy Ghost and you can't love folks. And so in this season, he says, I want you to provoke people unto love. In other words, the text is saying, your job as a Christian and a believer is to lure something or lure people into love. See, in this pandemic, we got it all messed up and we've been selfish and hoarding and stocking up and not thinking about anybody else. But in this season, we got to lure people to love. And then watch what the text says. I'm in the B clause of the text. He says, and not only do you provoke them to love, but also to good works, which means not only do you lure me into love, but then your love should have legs. Lord have mercy. Your love should have legs. You should be a blessing to somebody else. I know we're at a social distancing order. I know we're in a pandemic. I know we're stuck at the crib right now. And so right now where you're at, you can't go over your friend's house. You can't go over people's house and drop some food off. But what you can do, you can get online and have it sent to their address. You might not right now be able to put a dollar in somebody's hand, but what you can do, you can get online and cash at somebody and give them something. Quit being so selfish in this season and invest in somebody else. There's different outlets in which you can be a blessing to somebody, because there is a dying, crying world running out of hope, and you might be the antidote to change the whole trajectory of their lives and their belief in God. Man, I'm done. I'm reminded of the saints of old. They would sing, "My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name." Y'all, this is my part. I don't want to shout. I got to hold myself. It says, "On Christ the solid rock I stand. All the other ground is sinking sand." If you don't know that song, how about this? If you can't do another song, I'll just tell you that he died one Friday on a cross called Calvary. They drove nails in his hand. They drove nails in his feet. They pierced him in the side and he died. But that ain't how the story ends. Bright early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands. And because he got up, I got help at home. God bless you, is my prayer.
Wow, 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 wow. Y'all need to put some claps and some thank yous in the comments for how God used my brother. That's my friend. That's my brother. Reverend Nathan Caldwell, can you give God praise for him? Help at home. Amen. God is saying, listen, you may not be able to go to your church building, but I'm not just the God of the church building. I'm the God who will meet you at home. I'm the God who will heal you at home. I'm the God who will help you and deliver you at home. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad that God can help you at home? Hallelujah. Glory to his name. Thank you, Reverend Caldwell. What a word. What a word. What a word. What a word. Listen, after hearing a word like that, someone may be listening and you don't know the God who helps us at home. You don't have a personal relationship with Jesus the Christ, the one who he talked about on that Friday, who died for your sins and mine, was buried in another man's grave, rose for another man's justification. And now, because he lives, we can face our tomorrow. Because he lives and because of what he did on that cross, you and I can be saved. You and I can have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Listen, if you're listening and watching today and you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, I invite you to do it right now. How do you do it, preacher? You confess and you profess that you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died for your sins, and that God raised him from the dead. If you can believe that, and if you can say you believe it according to the word of God, you're saved. Listen, if that's you and you can believe that today, I want you to repeat after me very quickly. Say, "Lord, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died for my sins, and that God raised him from the dead. And right now, I'm a child of God. I'm born again. I'm saved forevermore." If you just prayed that with us, we celebrate with you. We're so excited for you and what God has just done in your life and this new start that you have just received by professing your belief in Jesus Christ and what he did for you. Listen, if that's you today, I want you to connect with us. I want you to connect with us. There are a couple ways you can do that. You can send us an email at jesussaves@firstbcfranklin.org. jesussaves@firstbcfranklin.org. You can also just inbox on this Facebook page. Just send us an inbox. Let us know you're one of the ones who came born again today. You're one of the ones who want to connect with this church and with this ministry. And if you want to go old school, you can just write us 318 Hall Street, Franklin, Virginia, 23851. Listen, I don't know about you, but I enjoyed myself today. And I thank God again for the anointing and the gift of my friend and brother, Reverend Nathan Caldwell. Thank you so much again, Caldwell, for being with us. Thank you for joining us. Want to pray for you before we leave today. Father, in Jesus' name, we give you glory, honor, and praise. Thank you that you promised that you are a very present help in the time of trouble, even when that trouble is at home. So I pray for every person who's watching, who's listening today, that they would be encouraged, that they would be reminded of the hope we have, that they would hold on to their expectation and know that you are faithful to all of your promises. Father, I pray now the blessing of the Lord upon your people now in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. We love you, and we'll see you next time.